Hello friends, welcome to Smart News Digital. Today, let's see the current affairs of 3rd September 2018. The news articles we'll be seeing today are these six. Let's see them all in detail now. The first article we'll be seeing today is with respect to Indian GDP growth. Risks remain on GDP growth. As we saw in an article couple of days back, Indian economy, it grew at a very impressive rate of 8.2% in the April-June quarter when compared to last year at the same time. This is the highest growth rate in the past 9 quarters according to the data available as per the official GDP data set. And this growth is attributed to 3 main sectoral growth. Number 1 is due to the extensive growth of manufacturing sector. It grew at a percentage of about 13.5% when compared to minus 1.8% at the same time last year. Apart from manufacturing, construction and agricultural sector also grew at a rate of 8.5% and 5.3% respectively. And another factor which led to growth in GDP is due to the implementation of goods and service tax. Because of the implementation of the goods and service tax, destocking of firms happened. That is, many firms which were before in informal sector, they became formalized, which was also explained well in the economic survey this year. All these factors, they contribute to 8% plus growth rate of GDP this year. Steady upward march in Indian economy is expected in the coming quarters. This is due to 3 main factors. First factor is due to resolution of several problems which were created with the implementation of GST. And now most of the problems are resolved and this will contribute to betterment of Indian economy. The second factor is budgetary support to rural economy is high now. This will also have a positive impact on our economy. And there's recently the government of India, it changed the base year to 2011-12. And this will also contribute to a positive development with respect to GDP growth in our country. But however, all is not well with respect to Indian economy. It does have certain restrictions and limitations. One of them is physical and current account deficit are increasing. And this may lead to inflation in our economy. For example, about 86% of budgeted physical deficit target for current financial year has been reached within the first quarter itself. So this is a major concern to Indian economy and this may result in inflation. Even the GST collection has dipped in the current quarter when compared to last year. And in addition to GST collection, there's another factor of falling rupee and the oil price trends. It also causes problem to Indian economy. And the service sector in our country, which contributes to major share to Indian GDP, it has decelerated in the last few quarters. And the service sector, which contributes a lion's share to Indian GDP, its growth rate has decelerated when compared to last year at the same time. So this is also a very major concern to Indian economy. Apart from this, though the Indian Meteorological Department has predicted a normal monsoon this year, regional variation does exist, which will affect the Indian agricultural sector, which in turn will affect the Indian economy. The Central Bank of India, that is RBI, it has already hiked the interest rate twice in the last couple of months and it is unlikely that it will ease the monetary policy in the years to come. So it is also a major concern as there is an issue of lack of job creation in our economy. So all these vital indicators to Indian economy need to be sorted out in order to achieve 8%+ growth of Indian economy in the years to come. For this, a proactive policy making and continuous pursuit is necessary to achieve this. The second article we'll be seeing today is with respect to India and US relationship, retail therapy on India-US 2+2 dialogue. So as we all know, 2+2 dialogue is about to take place on September 6th between External Affairs Minister and Defense Ministers of India and their counterparts from United States of India. And this is a very significant development in relationship between India and USA. This 2+2 dialogue will talk about several areas and one important area among them is the defense sector. And this article mainly concentrates among the defense relationship between India and USA. So proposals amounting for about 46,000 crore are approved by Defense Acquisition Council, which will likely to boost defense cooperation between India and US in the days to come. Among the approved proposals, 2 are very important. You can remember these names for the prelims questions. Number 1 is 24 multi-role helicopters which are anti-submarine warfare capability for Indian Navy is approved. And this approval is via government-to-government deal, that is Indian government and the US government deal, via Foreign Military Sales Program. There is a special program called as Foreign Military Sales Program, which will deal about the defense acquisition between both the countries. The acquisition is done via that program here. And the second acquisition is 111 Navy utility helicopters, and this is done via strategic partnership model. And this strategic partnership model is recently in news for several days. You can concentrate on this area also. Apart from these two agreements in defense sector, sale of armed drones from USA to India and the foundational agreement of communication compatibility and security agreement will also happen in 2+2 agreement in September 6th. And this communication compatibility and security agreement, it deals with the sale of encrypted systems from USA to India and to India to USA, and will also enable communication interoperability between Indian military and USA military. These developments of defense relationship with India is very important, especially for United States, as these initiatives will fit into US strategy of strengthening defense cooperation. This is a strategy of United States of America. In this strategy, it has elevated India as a major defense partner, and it has also simplified the license requirements for acquiring technology from USA via trade. This is because, according to USA, India is center of USA's Indo-Pacific strategy. So this strategy aims to deepen the strategic partnership and support of India in the area concerning Indian Ocean region and also the border region in the Indian Ocean area. However, the big question is, how long will it take in order to implement all these deals? So this is a very big question which needs to be addressed. And most of these programs, they also lack clarity in some areas. For example, India needs to be very clear about the implementation deal in strategic partnership policy with USA before implementation of the deal. And India is also highly concerned about countering America's Adversaries Act of USA, in which India may face sanctions if it deals with defense cooperation with Russia. It is very important that India must retain its independent national security and foreign policy, being world's largest democracy. And in order to upgrade this, India must seriously cope up and increase India's domestic defense manufacturing. India cannot aspire to become a global power unless it becomes independent manufacturer of defense technology. Only if India starts manufacturing its own domestic technology, it can give away the tag of being world's largest arms importer every year. The third article we'll be seeing today is with respect to disaster management in our country. For a shift in gear on managing natural disasters. Disaster management is a very important issue for the exam, especially in the light of the recent Kerala floods. So this article begins with Kerala. Kerala has a unique topography. So it is a coastal area as well as it is a hilly area. So it is vulnerable to several natural disasters like landslides, flooding, coastal erosion are some of them. And the incidences of flooding, especially in the recent days, have increased exponentially in all the coastal areas in our country. And this massive flooding in the state of Kerala has affected more than 1 million people, and most of them are still living in the relief camps located in different parts of the state. In this area, it is very important to remember about the Madhav Gadkil Committee. So this Madhav Gadkil Committee was set up by ecology experts in order to recommend reforms in order to manage the Western Ghats area. It recommended that the Western Ghats should be graded into 3 ecologically sensitive zones with significant restrictions and bans on construction and mining activities. However, these reforms were not accepted by the state government of Kerala and they were not implemented. So this part of the article, it analyzes how vulnerable India is, especially to the natural disasters. So India is prone to many disasters, as we know. And it is said that about 70% of India's coastal regions, it is prone to tsunami and cyclones. And about 60% of India is prone to landslides and earthquakes. And about 12% of India is prone to floods. So almost every part of India can be affected by some form of natural disaster. With the increased urbanization, which led to multi-story housing in urban areas, most of the buildings are built upon pillars and the brick walls. Especially with ground floors allocated to parking, the construction design in our country, it definitely requires retrofitting in order to avoid significant losses. This calls for a specific engineering called as earthquake engineering, which has to be taught with specialization to the civil engineers, which is not present in most of the universities currently. This is a major area of concern which needs to be addressed in order to avoid further losses. So, what are the problems faced by India with respect to natural disasters? The first is the risk management. Risk management capability of India is very, very low. For example, in case of Kerala, the Home Ministry has proposed in 2003 to form a specialist team in order to manage disasters using 4 battalions. So this 4 battalions will comprise of Central Industrial Security Force and Indo-Tibetan Border Force, both of which are paramilitary forces. However, Kerala government must identify state level training institutions for this purpose. So this project was finally not implemented and the project was completely forgotten. And another significant example is the state of Uttarakhand in India. It faced floods in the year 2013, which led to significant losses in the state of Uttarakhand. However, even after facing such a scenario, the forecasting facilities for floods in India is very, very low. For example, technological improvements like using Doppler radars in order to provide alerts in case of cloud bursts and heavy rains is still absent in many of the states. The next problem with India is there are very few guidelines in the areas concerning construction of buildings in flood-prone areas. We don't have a map of safe zones which can be used for construction guidelines in flood-prone areas. For example, out of 5,000 large dams existing in our country, only less than 200 dams have emergency action plan in order to cope up with the flood-like situation as it occurred in Kerala. This is a very serious area of concern which needs to be managed. And we also have a specific specialized National Disaster Response Force in our country, which was established under National Disaster Response Act. However, this national force, it suffers from shortage of trained manpower, infrastructure and equipment, which is rightly pointed out by the report released by Controller and Auditor General of India. And another problem in case of India is the regional differences. So each state and district of India has different norms for labor and construction. There is no uniform norms when different states are considered, which is a problem. Because of this lack of uniformity, for example, if a disaster occurs in Goa and Bundelkhand, same amount of money is allocated to both the regions Goa and Bundelkhand. However, Goa is a very developed state, whereas Bundelkhand is a backward place. So the funds allocated in case of disaster must be proportional to that. However, the current norms do not differentiate between the states, which creates such problems. Another important problem with respect to disaster norms in our country is they remain cool towards rural areas. They focus on agriculture, fisheries, livestock from relief's perspective only. Typically, after a disaster, revenue officials are responsible for visiting the areas affected by disaster in order to identify the loss and in order to provide relief to the affected people in that area. However, due to the human intervention, there is high scope for misuse and corruption in this area, especially in a crisis situation like flood. And the norms which are present currently, they completely exclude anyone living in unauthorized area, which is against the right to humanity. The current norms are also favorable only to big farmers, and they completely exclude sharecroppers and agricultural laborers, who in reality are the most affected ones. And apart from these problems, only the listed disasters get major chunk of central funds. The unlisted disaster, which do not gain significant attention from the government as well as the media, they are limited to only 10% of calamity relief, which is no way sufficient for the relief operations. All these problems which we saw now definitely calls significant reforms in the disaster norms existing in our country. So the planned urbanization which is happening in our country must be in a way that it can withstand all the disasters. India can take example from Japan, which continuously faces earthquakes every year, and in spite of that, it is capable of designing an infrastructure capable to withstand the earthquakes. The second reform is Indian Disaster Resource Network should be institutionalized, and a repository must be created in order to store the information about all the equipments and the information with respect to past disasters, so that it will be helpful in managing the disaster which may occur in the future. India also needs a very strong disaster management agency. This strong disaster management agency can only a strong disaster management agency can create both short-term and long-term rehabilitation strategy in order to withstand the disasters. It is also very essential to enhance the awareness among people, especially among the citizens, in order to deal with such situations like disasters. The National Disaster Response Force must fill all the vacant specialist positions with eminent persons in order to get better control over the situation. Without such reforms, only Indian Army and paramilitary forces can come and handle the situation, and states will continue to remain idle in case of crisis situation. And without any such suggested reforms, only Indian Army and paramilitary forces will be capable of handling such a situation, and Indian states will continue to remain idle without coping up with the situation. Perhaps it is the high time that India brings in such reforms and improves the resilience capability existing in our country. The fourth article we'll be seeing today is financial savings are up, but cash is the king again. We all know that demonetization was brought in a couple of years back, and it led to significant changes in the way cash is saved in our country. In a recently released RBI's annual report, it shows that households sharply raised their financial savings in the financial year 18, which is a very good trend. So this shows the financial assets increase. In 2017, it was about 14,000 and now it is 18,000. However, the disturbing trend is the households, they again went back and started holding cash with them instead of saving amount in the bank accounts. For example, this shows it. In FY17, 9,419 bank. However, in FY18, it almost reduced to half because of the cash holdings. So here the currency stored by the people within them, it saw a high increase. And another important trend is the shares and the debentures category of savings saw a significant rise. See, this is a share in debentures. Earlier it was around 300 and something. Now it is almost increased five times. And this also shows that only affluent classes of people, that is upper middle class and the upper class people, they invest in share and debentures. However, the middle and the lower middle class people, they continue to store cash. However, in spite of bank deposits being slumped, liabilities in the form of loans, they rose. This is because the small businesses which come under household category, they have borrowed more due to the difficult times which they faced in the past 1 year due to demonetization and implementation of the GST. The fifth article we'll be seeing today is, why is public credit registry very important? So what is public credit registry? So a public credit registry is basically a repository of information. So it stores all the information with respect to the loan givers and the loan collectors, both individuals as well as the corporate borrowers. So such a registry is very essential in order to differentiate between bad loans and good loans, and bad borrowers and good borrowers, and provide very attractive interest rate to good borrowers and higher interest rate to bad borrowers. This PCR was recommended by a specialist committee headed by Y.M. Dio Satley. And this PCR is very essential in order to address the issue of information asymmetry that is existing between the banks and the borrowers in our country. In the light of increasing non-performing assets that the banks are facing, such a PCR will be a very significant step to curb the issue of non-performing assets in the days to come. And this PCR will also improve India's rank in World Bank's Ease of Doing Business Index, as the business owners will be easily able to borrow money from the banks with significant rate if they come under the category of good borrowers. And with the PCR, the data will be available to the shareholders such as banks. At the same time, the privacy of the data stored in PCR will be protected. So why is this PCR necessary? So the central information which is available now is highly fragmented. For example, data on borrowing from banks, non-banking financial companies, corporate bonds, debentures, ECBs, that is external commercial borrowing, or foreign currency convertible bonds, masala bonds, and other ways of borrowing, they are available in different areas. We do not have a uniform repository in order to store all the borrowing data of different customers. So this creates a problem in order to assess how much loan an individual or a corporate person has got, and only if the information is available, the banks can classify them as good or bad borrowers and give different interest rate accordingly. So this PCR system will provide an early warning methodology and a quality check so that the loans provided can be tagged and they are not converted into non-performing assets. Another significant improvement is that if the credit data is available, then the amount of credit available to micro, small and medium enterprises will definitely increase. And this will contribute to the financial inclusion in our country and will also lead to increase in jobs available to youths in our country. The last article we'll be seeing today is new hybrids will help raise yields of silkworm farmers. So this article is with respect to the prelims perspective. Sericulture, that is the art of rearing silks, which is practiced by Indian farmers apart from agriculture, it could see higher yields in the days to come. This is because the Central Silk Board has notified a newly developed mulberry vanya silkworm X. So this silkworm X is named as PM into FC2. So this is capable of producing about 60 kgs of cocoon per 100 disease-free layings. So this name you should remember, it can be asked in the prelims question. So earlier variety which was used is PM into CSR. Now it is replaced by PM into FC2. So this new mulberry variety, it will be very suitable for farmers, especially living in areas of Tamil Nadu, Karnataka, Andhra Pradesh, Telangana and Maharashtra. And soon this will be available for commercial production. Thank you.